Peggy Holman, welcome to the series Exploring the Future of Western Civilization.
Thank you, Nicholas. It's great to be here with you.
Peggy lives in Seattle. It's currently snowing where she is. She's an author and a consultant. Her specialism is in social technologies that engage whole systems, complex systems of people, whether it be communities, organizations, and she helps them go through a whole range of group processes to work out what is their future vision, their future strategy. And she does this anything from small groups all the way up to thousands of people engaging on complex problems. She's worked in many places, but those include Boeing, Microsoft, the National Institute of Corrections, and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. A few years back, she co-founded the organisation Journalism That Matters, which is a national coalition of journalists, educators and reformers who are trying to reshape news and the information ecosystem. She became very prominent when she published her now famous book, The Change Handbook, which is like the Bible of organizational change processes, with 61 different processes outlined, but kind of an off-the-shelf how to do it book, which is really useful. Most recently, she wrote a book, Engaging Emergence, Turning Upheaval into Opportunity, which is really a big picture book, and she says that's a roadmap for tackling complex challenges, engaging emergence, and it provides stories, principles and practices for inviting people to come together and turn the disruptions into possibilities. So welcome, Peggy.
Thank you. So, as I say, it's great to be here. It's always interesting to hear my life through somebody else's speaking of it. So,
did that sound right? So would you add or subtract to that?
I think you covered it quite nicely. So
thank you.
Thank you for that.
So I suppose can I start with a really big picture question? How can we boost, as we being Western civilization, how can we boost our civilization's sense of self-confidence and direction?
That really is a big picture question. I'd like to answer it at two levels. In part because it's such a big question, it causes me to want to give a really simple, easily graspable, step in and do it kind of answer. So I want to answer at that level and then give a little larger picture answer. So my simplest answer is by asking good, appreciative questions. And I say that because, you know, ultimately, and you'll probably hear this theme throughout, whatever we do, if you look at patterns of change and how emergence, which I would loosely define as order arising out of chaos, how it happens, it's always about the actions of local agents, and that's you and me. And so what we do as individuals really does matter. So much today of the influences of, kind of Western thinking is very much in a problem a solution kind of orientation. And because of that, we tend to become experts in our problems and focus on them and go more deeply into them. And the funniest thing, what research now tells us, that we get more of what we focus on. And so if we're focusing on, and our minds don't understand the knots, so if we're focusing on having less violence or, you know, less of a bad effect on something, well, guess what? We get more of that.
Yeah.
And we've been doing that for quite a long time now.
Yes.
So at the level of the individual, if we start shifting the questions, as I do this a lot, of turning people's questions around when somebody says, how do we reduce the violence? I'll say, well, how do we create a healthier community? How do we turn the questions around? So the more of us who are doing that, looking for the, okay, given what's happened, what's possible now. So that's my local answer.
Yeah. Well, that question underpins this project because, or this series, because a few years ago I was looking into the so-called war on terror strategy about, you know, how are we going to win that? What are we going to do? And really, you can talk about what the others are doing and what we can do to stop them doing this. But the core question comes back to, well, who are we? How can we make our team so vibrant, dynamic and successful that A, our own people want to be a part of it and it's really successful, and B, others want to join us and don't want to attack us? And I noticed that question wasn't really being asked very much.
It's sad, but it isn't. And you actually reminds me, several weeks after 9/11, I was actually part of a panel. And of course, people in the room were still shell-shocked from the experience. And so we found in the part of this conversation, it was at a conference on change. Someone asked, you know, how would you destroy a network like Al-Qaeda? And the thing that I realized and said in the moment is you don't. You shift it, you make its purpose irrelevant. And that kind of work, I think, fits with what you were just talking about. If we become an attractive, welcoming, open society that is curious about and able to embrace difference, we create the conditions where where something like an Al-Qaeda becomes irrelevant. Let me say a few words about my kind of bigger picture answer to the question, because I think, you know, in the practical context, asking great appreciative questions is hugely practical. Having a context for how change happens, so that when we're faced with it, more of us are equipped to deal with it ourselves and bring others along with us, can also make a difference. So I'd like to say just a few words that I usually say a 50,000 foot level, but I'll say a 50,000 meter level, since the actual distance is arbitrary anyway. Kind of a big picture look at how change occurs in natural systems and social systems, and it's a pattern that I think has been named in a variety of ways. And I have found it very useful to look at the entry point into change, which is always through disturbance. And when you stop and think about it, it makes sense, because, of course, if there were no disturbance, there'd be no need for change. And so one of the lessons of that is when we're disrupted in some way, when something throws us off balance, our typical reaction and our understandable reaction is often resistance or denial or pushing back or trying to ignore it in some way. And and what happens is if we do those things, there's a high likelihood it won't go away. It will actually just get louder. And so the more we develop the capacity of relating to disruption by getting curious and learning about it, the more equipped we are to enter into change. And then the pattern that follows from that entry point, and by the way, this happens whether we're conscious of it or not, you often look at any kind of emergency situation. You have a huge disruption of some sort, a hurricane, an earthquake, or even losing your job. So it doesn't have to be man-made, and it can come from inside or outside the system that we're a part of. What happens is there is this sense of things falling apart, which, of course, puts us on an emotional roller coaster. But what's going on is it's essentially the elements that made up the system that gave it its shape and coherence, its stability, begin to unravel. And so if we enter into this period of differentiation, of being able to experiment, to be able to look at the aspects that used to exist that we want to keep and those that didn't weren't necessarily possible before and see what we want to embrace. We can discover the differences that make a difference. I do a lot of work with journalists. This is a field that is in the midst of tremendous upheaval. And those who are in the midst of creating the new are having a wonderful time, an exciting time, experimenting with how audience and interaction and how to do investigation, and there are just a myriad of experiments. Ultimately, those threads start pulling together into some kind of coherent form. Now, in journalism, that hasn't yet arisen, although we're beginning to see a little bits of the shape. We know it's more of a conversation than a lecture, for example. And ultimately, from disruption through differentiation, we end up with a new, ideally higher order coherence that has more aspects, people, or aspects of the system that weren't necessarily part of it before becoming part of it now. Mm. So that, to me, the more people who have a sense of that kind of shift, that kind of wave pattern of change, the better equipped we are to have a sense of cultural direction and self-confidence.
Because it becomes easier to let go or open to the change, because you understand it's yep. a healthy, natural process as opposed to catastrophe that needs to be stopped at all costs.
Yep. And frankly, you know, there may well be catastrophe in it. I mean, this isn't about denying that grief or fear or any of those things. They could well be a part of it. And I can still have faith that there's something on the other side. Because by definition, there's mystery involved.
Yeah.
You know, if I knew what was on the other side, it's not emergent. It's not...
No.
Change in the large sense of the term.
When you were talking there about change and how we can relate to it in a way that kind of embraces what's going on rather than being overwhelmed or resisting it, obviously journalists you're working with journalists, that's an important group who shape our group consciousness. And of course another group are politicians. And whilst privately some politicians might have the sort of belief system you're talking about, it's very difficult for them in our current, particularly the current media climate, to actually talk in that way, because if they don't stand up and say, I know absolutely everything, I know how everything works, I have all the answers, I'm super confident, and this is exactly what we must do, then they'll get, or if they, you know, express the ambivalence or paradox or uncertainty that's absolutely core to what you're talking about, the media has them like a pack of dogs, don't they?
It's an interesting challenge. I think both of those are professions that highly prize certainty. And ultimately, that is and will change. Because the disruptions are getting louder, I hear... through mainstream journalists, I hear the term unprecedented more and more. And I think we see the beginnings of changes in that arena happening, and I listen for it. Certainly the mainstream politicians do as you're saying. And I listen for the voices of the few that are indeed willing to express a different perspective. I actually, in the years that I've been doing this work, I have run into exactly one elected official who gets and practices in his own work the kinds of civic engagement that we're talking about. And he's a state senator from Hawaii.
Yeah.
But there's, I think there's a whole arena around civic engagement that is gaining traction, where if not the elected officials themselves, other government agencies that deal with the public are looking for more productive, more effective ways of engaging people in their, the citizenry in finding answers.
Could you give an example of that, of where that's been successful?
Actually, what's coming to mind is the work of Robert Putnam. Are you familiar with a number of years ago, he wrote a pretty well-known book called Bowling Alone, which correlated social activity with declining civic involvement. A number of years later, I think eight or 9 years later, he came out with a book, Better Together. Where he profiled, I think, 8 or 10 different locations. I think they were all in the U.S. But what he found were areas where the public had an active role and actually had funds to be able to make decisions, kept them engaged not only locally, but on all levels of politics. So, for example, in the city of Portland, Oregon, apparently Oregon state law puts aside some tax revenues for local communities to do their work. And they redesigned their roadways, putting more circles in through this kind of civic engagement activity. So there's a small example.
So as we started with one big picture question. Can I go with the next? What's your highest vision for Western civilization, or possibly global civilization?
You do ask big questions, I must say, Nicholas. It's
well, you're a big picture person, so
I have been accused of that. I think that we have such potential, and I think that as I looked at that question, I think a society in which the needs of individuals and the needs of the whole are met is kind of my simple encapsulation of my vision. And I say that because when I first got into the work of working with whole systems, one of the turning point moments for me was I was with a group in a company, and I saw something, and it was a highly contentious situation because labor and management contract negotiations were going on in the background. And I saw something that I didn't know was possible in that moment, which was that the needs of the people in the room, the individuals in the room, and the needs of the organization, and the needs of the unions could all be met. And until I had experienced that, I always thought that one or the other had to sacrifice, that it was always a trade-off. And what I've discovered is that when we create the conditions where people bring the best of who they are, where there's room for their fullest expression of what matters most to them, that this interesting, and it's almost contradictory, because it seems like that would create the conditions for wild chaos. And in fact, because as humans we draw from the same deeper core human values, ultimately through having the space to express our deepest desires, we begin to discover our places of connection. And a kind of wholeness emerges that makes room for what matters most and serves. And in the process, we begin to feel our sense of connection to each other. And in that moment, there's a shift that takes place when people begin to feel their connection not just to each other, but to a larger sense of wholeness. And we actually become a social body. And at that point, to undermine that social body is like cutting off your own hand. And so our behavior shifts. So, in that sense, while it doesn't sound like much on the surface to say, well, the needs of the individual and the needs of the whole are both met, my experience has been in working with a microcosm of an organization or a community, when those conditions exist, We treat each other differently. We listen differently. We cut each other way more slack, and our basic assumptions about each other's actions, even if they go awry, are to check out what the intentions, the underlying intentions really were.
Mm. So I can see how obviously that works in a small group, you know, creating a safe space and getting people to know each other, and you could almost bring together the most extreme opposites and see how they would be able to get on. But when they then leave the conference or the therapy room or the consulting room or whatever, and then go back to the wider system, what conditions are necessary in a big picture, you know, in a whole organization or a city or a country for that shift you just talked about to take hold and not slip back to the old, more divisive way?
This may sound overly simple, but practice. Mm. There is something about having that experience once that's magical. Having the chance to do it again starts to cause people to think, huh, maybe that wasn't just a fluke. And the more we do it, the more able we are to do it ourselves, to have confidence it isn't just an accident, and to begin to ask the questions of how do I get more of this? Yeah. So it's about creating a virtuous cycle. And one of the things that gives me hope and frankly, conditions could go either way. I am an optimist. I do think that we are on the beginning of an awakening of a different kind of consciousness, which has this greater awareness of ourselves, seeing ourselves in context. And I think part of that brings with it that shift from a problem-solution kind of orientation to a possibility orientation. So goodness knows we're all going to slip back. I have my moments of doubt as well, and they're fewer than they used to be. So there really is something about not just doing this once, but picking yourself up, dusting yourself off whenever you find yourself in a place of doubt or despair, and finding some place in it where you can ask a question that says, okay, yes, all that's going on, now what? And what can I do? Mm.
So I've heard you talk about, you've been talking about the emergence of something new, and as we were discussing before we got started, you know, it's very easy to come up with a massive long list of all the disasters and terrible things and threats and all the rest of it. But what are the positive new fresh shoots coming through? What's the first signs of some emerging new positive civilization that you see through your experience?
No, it's a great question, I'm thinking about a story from a journalist I did some work with. Actually, several journalists have said variations on this. One who, you know, a career journalist said at the opening of an event I was doing with journalists, she said, I got tired of being depressed all the time, so I decided to go look for something that was working. And she said, once I started looking, I could find things everywhere. And interestingly enough, I heard almost that identical statement from another journalist who said, we need a beat, a reporter's beat on change. Whether you're looking at philanthropy or healthcare or education, I would challenge you to look out your own window and your own surroundings. And the examples are myriad. I mean, think about, for example, in the world of finance, the Grameen Bank kind of micro-lending experiment that's pulling people out of poverty in developing countries and is now making its way into places like the U.S. in areas that are highly poverty-stricken. I think that there, you know, you can look at the slow food movement that is growing in terms of more locally grown food and weaving a tighter net of community. I just was in an area on a place called Whidbey Island that's near where I live, where over the last 10 years, this is a community that has built an extraordinary social safety net through the initiative of individuals in the community, where they've created things like a food bank that looks more like a grocery store, and put the resources in place to start training the next generation of farmers, because the average age of farmers in this country is in their early 60s.
Wow.
Which is kind of a daunting thought. As we think about where our food comes from. Or you can look at the educational system, and there are some really stellar experiments in places where kids have... there was a wonderful experiment using Appreciative Inquiry with kids that had been classified as high risk for dropping out of high school. And what they did was they started asking these kids, what does it mean to you to be a leader? And what they found was kids weren't necessarily interested in learning. They were very interested in being good leaders. And it changed their attitude towards learning and gave them a different context to understand what learning was about and why it was important. And they ended up with something like a 97% graduation rate.
Part of Appreciative Inquiry is to say what's already great about... the way things are. So what regarding Western civilization, or maybe America, if you want to narrow it down, what already is fantastic, and what's worth preserving and cherishing?
You know, again, you ask such bold questions. I found myself, as I contemplate that question, what immediately pops to mind is the creative spirit that's in us all. And I think Western civilization is particularly noted for better and worse, for, in a sense, the Newtonian Revolution and the things that we have been able to create out of stuff. I mean, the fact that you and I can be talking over and seeing each other over the extraordinary distance, you know, is a tribute to the kind of creativity that has, I think, created, you know, longer... longer lives. I think they have to date been healthier as we begin to feel the consequences of the downside of the way we've gone about that creativity, and see rising rates in cancer and so forth. We're beginning to see some downside effects, consequences of that. So as I think about you know, what's best in who, what we are, I say arts and culture, and our creative ability to do, to make both stuff, and deepen the connections across many cultures. And that one of our challenges in the coming era is to learn how to do that, being more mindfully connected with the systems of which we are part, knowing that we don't do any of that in a vacuum. Mm.
Thank you for that. I noted, actually, as an American, I expected you to say freedom and democracy in that list. Maybe you just missed it off by mistake, or maybe there's a reason for that. And I wanted to ask you, given your deep knowledge of change processes and engaging people, and in getting, how can we deepen and enrich our democracy so it isn't just a small cabal of people manipulating the media to get a vote, and then they go away and do what they like for 4 years? How can we actually, you know, democracy didn't start 200 years ago and then it's done. It's something we can do better. How can we improve it?
It's a really, really important question. And it's funny, I You know, I think of Greece as the birthplace of democracy. So it didn't pop to mind for me. But I think that democracy is, let's see, it is part of an evolutionary process in terms of how humans organize themselves to get stuff done. And there's an interesting book. Are you familiar with Howard Zinn's work? He's a sociologist. I know A People's History of the U.S., and I believe there's also one that's A People's History of the World. It's sort of a socialist view of history. He would probably object to that characterization. But it's basically, in reading his sweep of history, he'll talk about the people who are typically in power, you know, get their way, and then the people rise up and things improve and more people have more freedom, and then people in power squash them again. And you can watch this trend over 400 years of history. And his writing is actually kind of depressing to read. And yet, at the end of the book, when I sat back and looked at it, what I realized is that there is a trend in how we govern ourselves towards increasing self-authorization in the way it gets done. And that, to me, is the direction that we're going. I think the tools that enable us to connect many to many across distances are going to make a huge difference in supporting our ability to do that. And I go back to the thing that I said at the very beginning about needs of the individuals and needs of the whole, because I believe that part of that evolution of being able to you know, stand in our certainty as a doorway into engaging with uncertainty calls for each of us as individuals to bring forth our voices more fully. And I've talked about that a little bit. In a culture where that becomes normative, we become, I like to use the term, a differentiated whole, that it has in its nature the tension of that both and, of full voice individual expression while feeling connected to the other. And I think the patterns of democracy, the capacities to be in dialogue, are where those shifts are going. So I, you know, the democracies that and frankly the legal system that you know, we in the States inherited from you, is an advocacy-based system. It's based in win-lose.
Yeah.
And ultimately, we need to make the shift towards a dialogically based system, one that is where the emphasis is on inquiry and thinking together across our differences. They say that I've always found it intriguing that the shape of the U.S. Congress is a semicircle. And I know that Benjamin Franklin was ambassador to the Iroquois Nation, one of the First Nations people, who understood circular forms of dialogue. It's said of many Native cultures, you know, sitting around the fire in the circle, that they would talk and talk and talk until there was nothing more to say, and then they would go act. And the talk didn't even necessarily directly relate to the actions to be taken. And yet at the end of that exploration, people knew their roles, they knew how they fit into the larger system, and they were able to act from that perspective. Anyway, that's a full circle. And I always had the feeling that, and Benjamin Franklin brought many of the aspects of the democratic system that we use today, the checks and balances and so forth, from the Iroquois Nation, what he learned from them. And I always figured with the sort of semicircular seating, he got it half right. Somehow marrying it with an advocacy system based in win-lose, you know, cut off that ability to talk with people who see the world differently. And what I have observed over and over in working with groups around dialogue, and just a basic key I find in that is when, you know, when your impulse is to say to somebody, I disagree with that, and here's why, it's a great moment to stop that that impulse, take a breath, and instead say something like, "That's an interesting perspective. Tell me more about that." And then really listen, and listen to understand, not to be able to make a better case to debate the person and beat them at their own game. Because guaranteed, they won't tell you twice if you use what they tell you in that way.
Yes.
But typically, what happens, and again, there are wonderful stories of bringing people of different political persuasions. You can look at conversations. Actually, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, I think, is a wonderful example of bringing together people with very different worldviews who, you know, in that case, where you were dealing with situations of you know, death and violence and deep antipathy there in Northern Ireland, where people actually could sit across each other and speak truth to each other, feel heard and be heard. And that aspect in our democratic process, bringing the dialogic in, I think is the most critical shift that we could make in how we relate to people with different perspectives.
Thanks.
And actually what I know is that breakthrough answers happen because there are seeds of truth in every point of view. It's like the whole conservative progressive kind of tension that I think exists in most countries. I hear the arguments in my own country about bigger government. Nobody wants bigger government. We want a government that's the size to do what we need it to do and no more. And of course, organizations have a way of continuing to grow, so we need checks and balances on them. So, you know, what is it that we want to conserve that is useful about the role that we want government to play? And having the conversation about what's the role of government and therefore how do we fund it is a far more useful dialogue than arguing over bigger or smaller. One last thing I'll mention. There may be an equivalent in your country. There's an organization in the States and in Canada, the National Coalition for Dialogue and Deliberation, that is a terrific resource. Because its focus is using the kinds of conversational practices that have been at the core of my own work and learning about these kinds of shifts in social systems. But that is, it has its emphasis on civic engagement. And they are just a terrific resource for working with government and communities in dealing with questions important for civil society.
Peggy, you're an expert in group process and in change. How can we create a group process which will spread like a virus, a positive virus, self-propagating throughout Western civilization, to rejuvenate it, to engage the people, to get them excited about who are we, where are we going, and what's our vision for the future, and how do we make things better? What could that look like?
You know, it's in many ways, like many of the questions you're asking, it's a daunting question that I'm going to give you in many ways a kind of a simple answer to. Because I believe that is already underway, and it's underway in a way that isn't about a single process. This is a very, very complex, multifaceted challenge, and as such, there are people who are approaching it each from their own point of view, each from their own place of passion, and attracting others to them. And they're experimenting, and failing and dusting themselves off, picking themselves up, trying it again. But people of good heart, which is virtually all of us, who are asking, what can I do to make a better place? And there's a principle, I'd say, at the heart of what it takes for us as individuals and as a collective to deal with the emergent nature of change and evolution. And it's to me what's at the heart of one of the practices that's been most influential in my own work, open space technology. The way that I've come to frame it through the influence of friends and colleagues is to take responsibility for what we love as an act of service. Now, there's a whole lot packed into that phrase. For one, it goes to something that we've been talking about all along. The notion of paying attention to what you love. And sometimes it's phrased as, you know, where does my passion meet the needs of the world? So truly to ask yourself that question and encourage others to ask themselves that question. And in answering it, to act from that place. And my discovery is that when we do that, it truly becomes an act of service because we all are drawing from, you know, a core set of human needs to belong, to be able to contribute, feel safety in which to raise a family. There are just some basic things that matter to all of us, and so my encouragement is, if there's nothing else you take away from how do we bring about the kind of change that you're talking about, the more of us who liberate ourselves to act from that place, the more we will find our partners, and the more we begin a virtuous cycle in the midst of the kind of collapse of the assumptions of the way things have been. As those break down, there are 1,000 blossoms blooming. Everything from the transition town movement, or the Occupy movement, or the Arab Spring, look anywhere. There are revolutions in healthcare. There are revolutions in education. No matter what area you look at, there are people experimenting with new ways of operating. And so, for me, those are the group processes.
Yeah. And I noticed that you took an interest in the Occupy movement by getting involved in a thing called Occupy Cafe. What have you got involved in the Tea Party movement? That's a slightly naughty question, isn't it?
I honestly haven't, and my involvement with Occupy was because of an invitation. Had I gotten an invitation from a Tea Party person, I would have shown up.
Yeah. I suppose, what from your observations of those two, because one comes from a very, well, people know what they are. You know, they come from a very different sort of perspective. And are they groups of people doing exactly what you just described? Are they, how could they, is there a way they could come together in a transpartisan way that would be synergistic for the whole?
That's such a fabulous question, and I saw a diagram that made me laugh, again, because of its simplicity. And it showed, it was a Venn diagram, so two intersecting circles. And for the Tea Party, the circle is labeled distrust in big government. And for the Occupy movement, it's labeled distrust in big business. And guess what? There's this huge overlap of distrust of the intersection of big government and big business. So I think there's a tremendous ground for people to come together.
So the next question is, what do they? What's their overlapping bubble on? What do they trust? And I bet they're quite similar too, probably.
It could well be. That's an interesting question. Not one I've heard asked, and not one I've asked myself. There's a funny thing about that. I have a friend who homeschools his children, and he was telling me that it's a place where kind of those extremes kind of circle around and meet, because the people who homeschool children tend to be very progressive and fundamentalist in their religious point of view. Mm. Well, guess what? They have common cause around the well-being of their children. And so here you have these groups that may be politically at odds suddenly finding themselves as parents together. and in that, you know, discovery of our common humanity, new things can blossom. So I think we'll see more of those kinds of strange bedfellow stories coming together, because there's a place at which, you know, the extremes start looking more like each other than they know.
Yeah. I mean, you mentioned right at the beginning, September the 11th, Al-Qaeda. You've also mentioned the Arab Spring. Do you see a way in which those changes in the Islamic world or the Arab world it's easy to see them as a threat. We're familiar with seeing it that way. Is it possible to see them as a positive stimulus, a positive challenge, or a synergistic learning experience, something that will get us to step up and renew ourselves, be stronger, be better, learn from their strengths, or at the very least, stretch ourselves to be better?
I certainly hope so. And I actually suspect that some of the impetus and inspiration behind the Occupy movement itself is because of the Arab Spring. Mm. So I think it already has been an inspiration. It got me thinking about the time that was going on. I spent some time in South Africa and spent a day in Soweto, learning some of the story of the end of apartheid in South Africa. And shortly before that, I'd actually been in a place called Greensboro, North Carolina, which is sometimes called the birth of the civil rights movement in the U.S. And something that struck me in all three of these examples, whether it's the Arab Spring, Soweto and the end of apartheid in South Africa, or the civil rights movement in this country, all of them, the role of young people in being the spark for change. And I've been thinking about that a lot as well. And I have heard talk, we have an interesting time where we've got, the protesters of the 60s bringing their knowledge and skill of street organizing together with the tech-savvy 20 and 30-somethings of today. When put together, the potential to create something new and something better I think increases. And I'm reminded of Fred Pollack was, I think he was from the Netherlands. He was a social science researcher in the 50s, and he studied the rise and fall of civilizations. And one of the things that he found was you can predict the end of a civilization within a generation when it no longer has a positive image of its own future. It's really profound when you think about it.
Well, that's driving my interest in doing this, exactly that. That's really fascinating. It's amazing hearing you both talk about generations and about South Africa, because completely unsolicited, because those two themes absolutely run through all of these interviews, not because I've initiated them. There's something about the South Africa story which has really touched people and really is obviously part of Western civilizational mentality. It's fascinating. And also the generation thing is fundamental. Can I ask Peggy, how do we integrate our dark side? Obviously, I'm a psychiatrist, so I've got some ideas about doing that on an individual basis. But at a group level, how do we integrate those dark parts of our history or dark parts of that culture? The obvious things being, you know, past abuses or racism or differences in power. Those would be classic, but there are probably lots of others. I was talking to some Germans earlier today about how they've got a long way to go in reconnecting their, you know, they've kind of gone through their process of apology for the past, and remorse and guilt and shame and so on, but they've kind of left themselves in a rather broken state of, you know, okay, but what's next? You know, where's your healthy, positive vision of who you are? You need to put yourself back together again and be healthy. From your group process experience, how do we do that at a group level?
I think we need to talk to each other. It's a really, really important question. And it's a funny one because, as you've heard, a recurring theme in what I'm saying, coming from a possibility orientation, there is something about being present and unattached. And I don't mean unattached as I don't care, but unattached in kind of the Buddhist way of being present to without allowing it to hook you. And the gift that we owe each other is to be witnesses for each other. A number of years ago, I think it was 2004, I co-hosted a conference called The Practice of Peace. And it was actually, even its history, it was what inspired it. Harrison Owen, who created open space technology, was invited to Rome with 25 Israelis and 25 Palestinians. And all these, so these 50 people were flown to Rome because it wasn't safe to do this in Israel. And they spent 2.5 days in open space with each other around the issue of trust. And at the end of it, frankly, one of the things Harrison came away with was the insight that when we're faced with conflict, where our impulse is to shut down and to close in. In fact, what we need to do is open more space to ask a question that allows us to step in. And in a sense, that kind of work is an example to me of the work that needs to be done. And what we found, anyway, that event, coupled with some others, led to hosting this conference here. And we had people from conflict zones around the world, from Bosnia and Northern Ireland and Haiti and Nepal and Nigeria, inner cities, neighborhoods in the U.S. We had First Nations people. So it was a very interesting mix, and there was a point in the gathering. We had Israeli and Palestinian, and Palestinian woman showed a video of the building of the wall around the West Bank, because that was fresh at that time, and it led to this very respectful, heated exchange between the Israelis and the Palestinians, because they felt that the video, while attempting to show both sides, really didn't capture the fear that many Israelis felt that led to the building of the wall. The room witnessed that conversation. And as it wound down, nobody tried to fix it, nobody tried to intervene. The people in the room, and there were 60 or 70 of us, simply witnessed, held the container for that exchange to take place. And as it wound down without answers, the man from Northern Ireland stood up and talked about witnessing his sister being shot in a drive-by shooting. And the man from Burundi, who is there, spoke of witnessing his village being wiped out. And several others spoke the conditions that they had witnessed and been part of in their own countries. And the people, of course, who had come here were people who were seeking what's on the other side of that dark place that you're talking about. Again, no one tried to fix it or make it go away or do anything except listen. And the interesting thing was, the next morning, there was a spirit of joy and celebration that was extraordinary. And people came away with what they said. That event has ripples to this day. People came away from that experience more affirmed in themselves and their own capacity to go back in and be witness for those who were still angry or still hurting, and be able to provide for them the kind of deep listening that we, as a group, were able to provide for them. We have a lot of work to do.
Yeah. I certainly experienced that a lot as a as a junior doctor, doing the very unpleasant job of being on the emergency team, running around towards when the bleep goes, run towards violence, yeah. Which is the last thing I would normally choose to do, and in psychiatric hospitals, and it was amazing how often simply. Obviously, first of all, you have to have security. It has to be made safe, physically safe for you to be present. But once that is done, simply connecting and making rapport with the person who is apparently the aggressor and really genuinely listening, I'd say 9 times out of 10, that would resolve the issue and move you on, and you'd be having a I'd be having a cup of tea with them, not long after. And underneath was usually fear, shame, feeling not heard, feeling disrespected, those kind of things. Sometimes imagined and sometimes true. But it really struck me how dealing with violence, that worked as the solution very effectively most of the time. But you must have security. You can't do that if it's not safe.
Yeah. Safe space definitely makes a difference. This has popped through my head several times, but on the subject that we're talking about now, a colleague of mine, Mark Jones, described a process, a very simple diagnostic in the context that we're talking about, that he calls the HISL, which stands for hear, see, and love. And the idea is that we need to hizzle everyone, including ourselves. And the story behind it is he had an audience with the Dalai Lama in which he asked, how do we teach the children peace? And the Dalai Lama said to him, we all need to be heard, seen, and loved, or mischief occurs. And so Mark went home and he started observing and studying behavior and experimenting with it. And what he found was that when people don't feel heard, they shout or they shut up. And if they don't feel seen, then they get in your face and they turn into a bully or they become invisible. And if they don't feel loved, they do this kind of approach avoid of coming in and then... stepping back and coming in and stepping back. And what he found is in each case, the remedy is in the quality of listening. Mm. And I have, he invites people, now that you've heard of the hizzle, it's time to experiment it, join the experiment. And something that I have found is when I run into somebody who's really cranky or, biting in some way, rather than reacting to it, what goes through me now is, they're not feeling heard or they're not feeling seen. And so I'll respond to that perhaps with a question or, a naming of, I can tell that something just rattled you recently and you want to talk about it or whatever. But I'll listen to the deeper place in them and interact with that.
Hmm. As you're talking there, one of the threads that runs through Western civilization, both domestically and overseas, but particularly domestically, is the sort of hot topics of race, of immigration, of racism, and more recently the sort of Islamic aspect has been thrown in as well. And the response of the elites for a very, very long time has been to kind of have... This relates to the shadow question. I see political correctness as being like shadow prejudice. It's shadow racism. It's just turned on its head. And it's kind of like anti-fascism is fascism. It's the same thing, and just as violent and so on. And of course, well-meaning, but in terms of is it effective, does it achieve the desired aim? I would say it does the opposite. Political correctness and multicultural ideology and the laws that we have in, certainly in Europe, I don't know if you have them in America, which actually make it pretty illegal to have robust democratic conversations about issues of race and religion and so on, which is, democratically is insane. And in terms of evolution and emergence and what you were just saying, being heard, it is nuts, isn't it? What needs to be done at the civilizational level for us to let go of those kind of fascist, anti-fascist solutions of which is shadow racism and shadow imperialism, and actually own our racism, own our imperialism, and really, by when I say that, I'm talking to people who call themselves liberals, but actually carry a lot of shadow racism and shadow imperialism, and cover it up and project it onto other people. Anyway, sorry, a very long question. Punchline is, how can we drop those false structures and laws and actually enable people to engage in the positive healing process of hizzle, being heard, being seen, being listened to, actually genuinely healing the wounds, genuinely overcoming the problems, and actually moving to a healthy, conscious, positive state beyond all of that kind of old pathology?
Yet another of your big questions. the legal barriers are a challenge that we don't face in this country. The First Amendment of our Constitution is, the notion of free speech fortunately helps in that realm as much as it does in a variety of them. The legal question is not one that I have a lot of insight into. I guess the main thing I can say, like any form of civil disobedience, it takes somebody willing to begin and to reach out across, the lines of cultural or race or difference, and engage in the conversations, as we were just saying. I'm thinking about yet another South Africa story, the scenario planning work that happened, I think it was before Mandela was released, a group of South Africans from across all strata of that society came together to develop four possible scenarios for the future of the country. And there was no judgment put on right or wrong or better or worse. The notion was, what are the assumptions that we think are likely? And in picking a couple of those, then playing out the scenarios. And they landed in four scenarios. And they had different names of birds for them, and I'm the main thing I remember about them, because I don't remember in detail, was that one was a scenario in which they end up isolated by the rest of the world and in essence implode because of the kinds of financial embargoes that were placed on them. Another, they become a populist country and basically anyone with any resources flees. There was only one of the four scenarios, which was basically about finding a way to work together, that actually led to, a future that was desirable. And so there was never any voting or debating. It was simply a matter of this very different group of people talking. So I guess where I'm going is what made me think of the story is when there is something more important to us than the differences or the prejudices that we hold, that it takes us together to create, then people join forces. It's back to my example of the strange bedfellows of people homeschooling their kids with radically different beliefs, but a higher purpose of their children. And I think that's ultimately what will bring us together.
Is there anything that we haven't covered that you would like to say regarding the big picture question of how do we revitalize Western civilization?
I'll just reiterate something I think I've said, because I just think it's so important. It happens a person at a time. And the more each of us acts from the place of our own deep longing and caring, the more we will find we're not alone and find our partners and create the virtuous cycle that I believe we are already in.
Fantastic, Peggy. Thank you. Very finally, if someone would like to follow your work, look at your books, and maybe get in touch, how would you recommend them do that?
You can visit my website, peggyholman.com, and you can reach me at peggy@peggyholman.com.
Great. Thank you very much, Peggy.
You're welcome, Nicholas. Good to meet you. Thanks so much.